Freeway Ricky Ross is a street legend. He went from being a poor, illiterate, aspiring tennis star to one of the biggest drug dealers in Los Angeles history. After being part of an international drug ring and making up to $2 million a day, he's starting over from scratch and trying to build another empire, this time the legal way. 20 years of prison have turned this former kingpin into a fully literate activist who is trying to make a difference by keeping kids from following in his footsteps. Today, he sits down with RT to talk about his rise and fall and to discuss his connection to the CIA Contra controversy. Ricky Ross, thank you for joining us today. A lot of poor neighborhoods here in Los Angeles have suffered from gangs and drug abuse, and a lot of people blame you for that. Now, how do you think that you can help and rebuild these communities?
Well, I think I'm the perfect one for this job that needs to be done because, I mean, if you haven't lived this life, it's like an experiment. You know, my life has been an experiment. And had I not been through this experiment, then I wouldn't know what happened. You know, most people don't know what happened in South Central. They don't know how you get started selling drugs. They don't know how you get out of selling drugs. They don't know how you can go from being illiterate at 28 years old to being as literate as I am now. You know, basically, I do law work. You know, like I said, I'm filing my paperwork today in my lawsuit.
What do you think about the rapper Rick Ross taking on your persona?
He's never sold drugs. He's never been involved with any type of crime. You know, he was a college boy, played football, from what I understand, and he was a prison guard. You know, and you know, to be a prison guard, your record has to be spotless. You know, so he's definitely created a fraud, you know, he's perpetrating a lie.
What role did the U.S. government play in bringing crack cocaine into L.A.'s poor black neighborhoods?
The government needed this money to fight this war over in Nicaragua against the Sandinistas. Russia had gave the Sandinistas $100 million to fight with. Congress had cut off all the money from the Contras. So now the Sandinistas had an advantage. Reagan and Bush had made the Contras their pet peeve. They felt that if Russia took over Nicaragua, they would be too close to America. They would be in our backyard. I believe that they felt it was more valuable to sacrifice a particular sector of America and a race of people in America in order to save the whole country. So they let these guys open up pipelines. Danilo Blandon, Norman Nessus, and the rest of the crew that worked with the Nicaraguan connection. Because I knew about 10 or 15 different Nicaraguans that was all inside of this, you know, Contra organization that was selling drugs. So by them allowing these guys, or basically turning a blind eye, because I don't think the government necessarily gave them the drugs or whatnot, but in a sense, they sanctioned it because they turned a blind eye. They knew that these guys were selling drugs, but they did absolutely nothing about it. I also believe that had they not let these guys sell drugs, it's possible that I would have never become a drug dealer.
What does that say about our government when they're looking the other way while a deadly substance is coming into our communities for the sake of fighting a communist regime in Central America?
Well, it says that our government will sacrifice its people to accomplish a goal. And this is not the first time that they've done that. We've known numerous times in our history where they have sacrificed, especially the black man.
In that case, it's tough to hear that the ends justify the means.
They felt that it was more valuable for them to keep Russia out of America, you know, and for America to keep its way of life.
Do you think that the CIA or any other sort of government agency is still helping to funnel drugs into America?
Well, I mean, if we look at Afghanistan, you know, when the Taliban controlled Afghanistan, the flow of heroin was almost zero. And now it's up, you know, hundreds of percents more than it was at that time. So it makes you wonder. I mean, you know, what is really going on? How can the Taliban control drugs and now America can't? you know, control it. You know, heroin is on the rise again. And it's Afghanistan heroin.
The CIA connection to the Contras and the huge influx of drugs into Los Angeles wasn't exposed, wasn't made public until journalist Gary Webb started to report on it.
Gary was on a mission. You know, he didn't approve of what I did. But he said that if I was in prison, all the other players should be in prison right there with me. And that I shouldn't be used as an escape goat. You know, he felt that justice should be level. You know what I'm saying? Not to where if you got political pull or you got money or this, that you can escape justice. And that's how Gary felt.
Everything that Gary Webb said was eventually proven to be factual. So why do you think that it was so controversial when he was actually coming out with it? And why do you think that he was attacked so much by the mainstream media?
What they really tried to attack him on is they tried to say that he said that the government deliberately put the drugs into the black community. You know, they took his words and twisted them. And I never saw what he said that he think that, you know, the Bush administration or the Reagan administration or anybody went into an office and said, hey, you know, we're going to plan to put these drugs into the black community to destroy the community. That's not what he said. He said is that what I understood him to say is that they knew that it was taking place and that their workers, because the Contras was on the CIA payroll, so they was their employees, and that they did nothing about it.
Now, in some speeches, Gary Webb talked about how the DEA told them that what he was reporting on would put people's lives at risk. Now, do you think that was just a scare tactic? And are there parallels from what was happening then to what is happening right now? Today in the news, we hear about WikiLeaks exposing all these U.S. military secrets. And we're also hearing on the news that these secrets are supposedly putting people's lives at risk. I mean, talk about the similarities.
I mean, our government is really out of control. You know, DEA, FBI, they're really out of control. Nobody, I mean, like, when we find wrongdoing in our cases and stuff, there was nobody that we could run to and say, hey, you know, this guy is doing such and such and such and such. You know, even with the crooked cops, it was nobody that we could go to express what was going on, that these cops were beating us. You know, these cops busted my head open and with flashlights. They let a dog bite me while I was handcuffed. But there was nobody that we could go to and express what was going on.
You didn't even know how to read when you got out of high school, yet you were still able to run a multi-million dollar business. I mean, how is it that you're able to go through school and never learn how to read?
Well, the teachers really weren't interested in teaching me. They were interested in getting a paycheck, which is another one of America's way of thinking. See, America's not thinking about getting smart. They're thinking about getting a check. And when you think like that, then all you want is the money and the hell with the product, you know. So what I've learned is that the product is the most important thing. You know, being in the game is more important than getting the money out of the game.
Tell me about your involvement in the hip-hop game.
My pet project is a social network website that I started right now. It's called freewayenterprise.com. We're the biggest social network on the West Coast. We just broke inside of 100,000 ranking in the United States. I think we're 330,000 in the world. So it's growing. I think we reached those numbers faster than even Facebook and MySpace did. So I'm making some progress. With that, it's a platform where artists can come on, put their music, and be discovered by different A&Rs come on there looking for artists. I myself looking for artists to sign to my label.
Back in the day, rappers used to talk about real issues in the ghetto. What happened? Is hip-hop watered down?
They don't know what's going on in the streets. They don't know about the struggles. Because when rap first started out, you know, they talking about, I mean, you know, the ones that I first started with was Rapper's Delight. The guy talked about his son was telling the dad that he didn't want to go to school. He said the teacher was a jerk. She must think he was a fool. And all the kids smoke weed I think it'd be cheaper to get a job and learn to be a street sweeper.
My son said, Daddy, I don't want to go to school because the teacher's a jerk. He must think I'm a fool and all the kids smoke reefer. I think it'd be cheaper if I just got a job, learn to be a street sweeper.
So he was talking about what he was going through, you know, what he thought about school, what he thought about his teacher, you know, what he thought about all of the people around him. But that's not happening now. These guys just found somebody that was glamorous, you know, which was us drug dealers, and that's all most of them talk about right now.
Now, when you talk to young people, what is it that you really want to stick to make sure that they don't follow in your footsteps?
You know, I don't care if you don't learn nothing else in school, but learn how to become a critical thinker. Learn how to decide what is right and what is wrong for you.
Ricky Ross, former drug kingpin, hip-hop entrepreneur, and multimedia executive, thank you so much for joining us today.
Man, thank you for having me. I mean, it's wonderful, you know, and you know, hopefully we can get this message out, man, and save America.